So here we are, live at the Dance Centre. I'm Martha Carter. We're in Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada, and we are about to start our live stream rehearsal of Speaking in Ligeti, which is a choreography with four dancers and live string quartet, Microcosmos Quartet. Let's go see if they're ready. Come on. Hello, anybody there? Are you guys ready? Say hi to the camera, you guys. You guys are live stream. Okay, so Jocelyn, let's go. We got to get this party started. Okay, here we go. Follow us back to the theater. We have a live audience here with us today. Hello, everybody. I'm Martha Carter. I'm the artistic director of Marta Marta Productions and the choreographer for Speaking in Ligeti, which we are going to show you some excerpts of in our rehearsal today. And as you are aware, we are showing this live broadcast around the world. So hello, everybody out there. I think it's 6:30 in the morning in Hong Kong, 11:30 p.m. in London. So. We'll see how this goes, and it'll be interesting to see who comes on online to check this out. So with me here is Jocelyn Morlock, composer in residence at the Vancouver Symphony Orchestra, and tell us a little bit more.
Oh, well, hello. It's lovely to be here. I think this is actually the first time that I'm going to personally experience dancers dancing improvisatorily live to my music. So I'm really looking forward to that. One thing I think Ligeti and I have in common is that we have very visceral, rhythmically charged music, something that really lends itself well to being enlivened by gestures and dancers and movement. So I'm really looking forward to experiencing that for my piece, Disquiet, and also the Microcosmos String Quartet doing that with Ligeti's first quartet.
Indeed. So we will start with what we call Speaking in Ligeti. It is a two-part piece, and we're just going to show you a few excerpts of that. And as we said, this is a rehearsal. Because we are preparing to take the piece on tour to Halifax next month. At the end of the excerpts of Ligeti, we will be showing you, as Jocelyn mentioned, an improv to one of her compositions, Disquiet. So that will be a little bit later on. So before we talk more, let's see some dance. We're going to start with what we call a duet with a cello, Becky Wenham on cello, and Hayden Fong dancing. And this duet we see as kind of a representation and embodiment of Ligeti's life journey, which was really a challenging one.
Do we want to speak a little bit more about Ligeti's early journey, or shall we head straight to dance and then we can tell people later?
Let's do that.
Okay.
Okay, so enjoy.
Thank you.
Thanks, you guys. So yes, let's just talk to the artists for a moment here. So here we have Hayden.
Hi, everyone.
And here we have Becky.
Hello, hi.
Let's hear Hayden's breathing.
Why are you sweating so much today?
Yeah, really.
Not shape.
So as I said at the beginning, when we were creating this, we talked about it being kind of an embodiment of Ligeti's difficult life. So do you want to just speak a bit about that for you as a performer and for you as a player? Maybe let you catch your breath and maybe Becky can say something?
About Ligeti and his difficult life?
Well, no, about how you are, your interpretation of that in that section.
I guess I would say that, well, I'm not sure how this ties into Ligeti's life exactly. I'm the third person, third musician to interpret this particular improv, so I'm trying to take elements of what Ligeti wrote, as well as elements of what Peggy, the original cellist, improvised, and then what Tanya improvised as well, and then still put a piece of my own experience into it, and then respond as well to Hayden's movements. And so we're creating this kind of a structured improv, and then I kind of went and did whatever I wanted today anyway, so it all just ends up being totally different than what you had planned, so that was what happened just now for me. What about you, Hayden?
I've done this particular duet quite a few times. I was with Peggy, the original cellist, when we first started creating it, and it originally just started as Martha asking a dancer and musician to pair together and just to jam out, and it just kind of really worked really well. Me and Peggy really connected, and we started kind of building this duet from there, and we started noticing kind of with the cello the just rawness of how the sound can come out of that, and just how we were able to create this kind of struggle and tension with the sound and the movement and how it related to Ligeti's life, where he basically just was confined for so long in wanting to create his music, just with the laws and the culture back then. He wasn't able to really, he had all these ideas, but he wasn't actually able to express them because everyone just told him, no,
this is the communist Nazi regime just holding him down.
So there's this whole kind of at the beginning where I'm feeling this confinement in my own body. And then from there, it kind of opens up and escapes, which then from that escape, all of a sudden there's this whole new world of possibilities and whole new mindset he can throw himself into, which is kind of that spiraling and just like that almost losing control and not able to really know what to do with all these ideas. And then from there, it's again like that kind of honing it in and trying to find exactly how it all fits and pieces together, kind of traveling and going to different countries and experiencing different musicians. And then finally at the end, it's just kind of that solidification, that understanding that he finds his voice. And it's just that kind of calmness and kind of understanding of what exactly he wanted to do.
I like how you did the dance again while you explained
that.
Yeah,
I know.
And Jocelyn did mention earlier how one of the reasons I find the music so interesting is that there's constantly some kind of tension in it and struggle inside of it. So it's just begging to be embodied as I start to dance with it, as I talk about it, right? So, I mean, what would you say about that?
Yeah, it's interesting because not knowing your context of the improv, I was hearing it sort of musicologically as Ligeti's early life. He grew up, he was Jewish, born in 1923, and he was caught between the Hungarian and Romanian fighting and was, you know, one time it was one language at school and another time. And then the Nazis came, his whole family was killed, and he escaped, I believe, between 5 and 7 times. It's incredible that he lived. So he, you know, he'd run in one direction and people ran in the other direction. Like, he had this incredible will to live. I just can hardly believe that it happened. But yes, he was writing this piece for the drawer. As you say, he was just putting it away, knowing that no one would ever play it necessarily until he escaped to Vienna and then had a first performance several years after by all probability, he would have died. So it's kind of incredible. So I just hear this huge tension and then like explosive release and then tension again where he's back trapped. So I suppose it's open, like a palimpsest, to several layers of interpretation, but certainly that life force and tension is really embodied by you guys. It's pretty amazing.
Well, thank you. Okay, well, so let's just meet the other artists while we're here.
Tanya Popoff, viola.
The Wen Glover,
dancer.
Andrea Sirazzi, violin.
Here, I'll let you do that side.
Hi, I'm Nicholas Lydiot.
Mark Destrebe.
Delphine Leroux.
And I know that the audience isn't necessarily hearing this microphone, but this is really for the online. So I'm hoping that the sound is okay.
Speaking of online. If anyone wants to tweet to us, we have Speaking In Ligeti, hashtag Speaking In Ligeti for anyone in the online audience.
Yes, thank you, social media. Okay, so we are going to move on and go into what we call excerpts from part one. And I'm calling this the Drone Shimmer Continuum Motif Chairs and Hayden Fast Feet section, which sort of sounds like a Ligeti composition of its own.
There will be a test on that later, so I hope you caught all the names.
So in the show, we have a first half and a second half. The first half is a deconstruction of the music. So that duet was the very beginning of that deconstruction. To do that deconstruction, it really was all about playing with the dancers and the musicians for them to try to find some language between them. And that was one of Ligeti's goals in his composition, was to find a new musical language. And he spoke so many languages, we felt like we needed to figure out how to speak his language, thus speaking in Ligeti, and how to speak it in movement, for the dancers to bring the music into their body. Over time, we felt like we started to see the music and hear the dancing. And that was because of this playtime that we use as our exploration of deconstruction, which now we will show you some excerpts of the Drone Shimmer Continuing Motif Chairs and Hayden Fast Feet. Enjoy.
Thank you.
Jocelyn, and Martha mentioned that Getty had a very difficult life. And one of the curious things, they talked about how he grew up in Transylvania and his interest in language. There's a nice little story that goes with that, is that in fact, until he was about 7 years old, he had no idea that there was any other language than his native Transylvanian, and was when he heard a policeman speaking on a street corner in Romanian. And that was his first inkling that there were other languages than the one he'd heard as a child. And then he went on to learn many other languages. He was also fascinated by mathematics, by the Fibonacci sequence, by structure. And as Jocelyn mentioned, this was, he considered this his prehistoric music or his destroyer music, because he hadn't actually heard it performed when he wrote it. He also hadn't heard the two pieces that most strongly influenced it, which were Bartok's second and third quartets, and that was what drew us as a quartet to playing it, because we were already working on those two Bartok quartets. His interest in mathematics is also an interest in cells, and this piece was quite fascinating in the way that he uses these very, very small musical elements, or very contained musical elements, and expands them in many different ways. And so we just wanted to show you a little bit of how he does that. I'm just going to play you a chromatic scale. I'm sure you all know what it is, but it goes like this. So just all the keys of the piano in order. Well, he uses that, but makes it sound like this. So those are all the notes that I just played, but he's displaced them up or down by one octave, and then given them widely varied rhythms so that you get a sense of great discordance, of jaggedness, of chaos. And he has all the four instruments doing the same thing also in juxtaposed rhythms, so he creates this wonderful sense of chaos in that particular section. The section just after that, somewhere about in the middle of the piece, he uses a very small chromatic cell like this. In the first violin part. At the same time as I'm doing that, the viola plays exactly the same cells, but one semitone lower, so it sounds like this. So you can hear just by doing that, he creates not just an interesting effect, but a wonderful atmosphere, a little bit spooky. Well, at the same time as we're doing that, the other two instruments are doing exactly the same thing, but one half beat behind us, which creates yet another kind of atmosphere. It sounds like this. So then you get that magically kind of speaking quality to it, the sense of conversation with this wonderful spooky atmosphere. At the very beginning of the piece, he starts with a kind of drone, and again has a rising chromatic line, and then this rather sad four-note motive that sounds like this.
Two, three, four. Let's do a practice. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if you kind of start me.
You do that often.
Can you do that?
Twirl around.
Never. First time.
No, first time.
Okay.
Do the same thing, except when we jump this time, we'll say ha.
Okay.
Yeah. So we get a bit of sound.
Okay.
Yeah. I won't jump this time.
Okay.
One, two, three.
Ha! Ah. Something else?
Sure. How about kick?
Okay.
Yeah. Your legs flexible? Mine aren't, so it's okay.
We'll see.
So same okay. thing. So we'll count to three and then kick.
Okay.
One, two.
Three.
Nice. So let's do, how about a lunge? Okay.
Crutches?
For a lunge?
Yeah. Well, I'll use my phone.
Thank you.
And you can see the end was Hayden Fast Feet. So as you can see, that the whole first section there, that excerpt and all the excerpts of the first section are really much about how to communicate between the musician, the composer, the music, the movement, the dancer, the dance, try to find a real true relationship and dialogue between, rather than having musicians accompanying dance or dance just being danced to some music, right? So that there's some real interchange. And we found that by doing that, it was a way for the musicians to find a new embodiment and the dancers to find new understanding of the music. And also, when we perform the full piece, there's that sense that by the time the second half rolls around and they play the full quartet, there's a sense that the audience have already heard all that music before. They understand it in another way, considering it's arguably difficult music. Somehow we kind of unveil it or kind of deconstruct it enough to make it a little more logical or a little more sensible or something. I don't know what word would you use?
To me, it actually feels like a process of getting to know it. It's almost like a stranger on the street, and you go, oh, that's that guy that's like the really frenetic guy that walks down the street real fast, and he seems like he's super caffeinated, or that's the really sad person. Or it's sort of embodying like the music in various directions. Feels to me like, oh, yeah, I already know this character, as if there's a lot of characters in the piece, like almost like human characters.
Oh, that's
my perspective.
In the early days, one of my images was a Thanksgiving dinner. I'm like, okay, why are all these people here together? Okay, they're all kind of coming together, alternative family arrangement or something, and that they're all coming together, and they're kind of arguing about a lot of things, or discussing, dialoguing, coming to terms with something, perhaps, somehow working through the issues together. And that image helped me bring the musicians and the dancers into the same space. So dinner, right? Dinner with instruments and dancers. Before we talk to the dancers about this section, somebody on Twitter or commenting online asked if we're live editing with a TriCaster, and I don't even, is this called a TriCaster, this equipment? Can someone answer? It's called a TriCaster? Yeah, okay. Yes, I guess we are. It's wonderful to have this equipment. Thank you to the Canadian Music Centre for helping us with this event today. They have this equipment, and they have started to do wonderful live broadcasting of musical events all over Vancouver. And it's a huge privilege to be able to try this with dance. I'm finding it's making me a little anxious behind the scenes there because I have so many choices. Usually I just look at the whole stage. But in fact, those cameras can capture all sorts of close-ups. And anyway, the team behind the scenes is doing a great job. So thanks, team. And it is a challenge. I think in the very recent past, this was mostly done by broadcast television stations. It's very unusual for a small nonprofit dance situation to be able to do this, and it's really exciting to have this opportunity. So thanks to everybody who's helped us, especially the Dance Center, to let us be in their beautiful Ferris family studio at the Scotiabank Dance Center. Another question, oh yeah, that could use some applause, right? Thank you, thank you. Thank you, Dance Center. And another question is, why is the metronome so important in this performance?
Yeah, it was an interesting question. Like, yes, the metronome. Well, Ligeti Loved metronomes is the short answer. He actually wrote a piece for 100 metronomes in approximately 1962, so a little after this piece called Poème Symphonique, in which 100 metronomes are set off and they all just tick. And he had this kind of a mechanico style, he called it, that seems sort of like demented mechanical music, and it's a bit dystopian, but it's something that he returned to, and he wrote very mechanistic music also for live instruments sometimes, as opposed to the metronome. But that sort of fervent mechanistic energy is a really big part of his output, his mature output, and so I presume that is in fact why we are using the metronome at this time.
The second half of the piece, and most of the piece, in the second half of the piece, they play the full string quartet number one, and most of the piece is based on the motifs from string quartet number one. But in listening to a lot of his music, I realized that quartet number one, which was one of his desk drawer pieces because he couldn't play it live when he first composed it, a lot of the motifs in that end up becoming full compositions in his later music. And so in a way, this what you heard as soundtrack in the first section are actually glimpses and excerpts of his other music in reverse chronology, and so we lead it back to quartet number one. And that's kind of a geeky musical inside scoop on how we kind of structured it. And so one of the things that you see in the full piece right before they play the full quartet is excerpts from Poème Symphonique, excuse me. And it is actually projected as a video as well, and you actually hear parts of the soundtrack of this chaotic multi-rhythmic ticking. So it is in the piece, we're just not working on that section today. So what we were really working on in this section is working on the timing, the rhythms, the interaction between the musicians, and actually let's talk to some of the artists about it. Let's start with Mark. Mark Destubay, tell us a little bit about how that section, or what it's like working in this way for you.
Well, I should just first say that Martha and I have known each other for decades, I won't say how many, and I think that the first collaboration we did quite a long time after we got to know each other was doing music by Bartok for two violins. I think that was the first thing we did. And one of the wonderful things with working with Martha is that she's actually a musician as well as a choreographer, and that's quite unusual for us to be working with choreographers who actually deeply understand music, so it was a big privilege to be able to just be able to take for granted that she understood what the music was about and could use that in a...
See, Mom, music lessons.
Well, they were... Thank you, Marnie. Mom Marnie's a pianist. And so Martha came and heard us play the Ligeti Quartet actually at the Canadian Music Centre, I think, down the road. And so thank you, Canadian Music Centre, even though Ligeti wasn't Canadian. And she said this would be a great piece to put dance to. And so we entered into a set of conversations that went on for quite a long time about how the music wouldn't be just there as a vehicle for the dance, but how we could use the dance as a vehicle to make the music visible, as Martha just described. So that put a little bit of a task on me to sit down with a score and actually figure out how the music was constructed, and this is where I came to realize that this music was actually really fantastically interesting in the way it was constructed in these little cells. So the piece is actually in one long movement. There's no break at all from beginning to end. It's about half an hour. But it's in fact in 17 sections, and it flips back and forth from slow to fast to slow to fast, and always using these very small elements that are somehow reimagined in these new ways that create each one creates a not only a different sound effect, but a completely different musical and emotional effect. So the outcome was that we, in a way, the music is using the dancers to make the music visible, and I think that idea that we can use movement in our very visual society to make music more visible for an audience is a wonderful thing. So thank you, Martha, and the dancers.
It's really great to get the violinist running. Yes. So willingly. How's it for you to work with this kind of music, Nick?
It's really interesting because it's really rare nowadays that as a dance artist you get the opportunity to work with live music in a performance setting. So in that sense it's really invigorating because I find as a dancer we're always being blasted by music from monitors at the front of the stage, and the sound is always coming from in front of you. And as a trained dancer, we're always—I'm at least personally—you know—I find we're always taught to be very frontward with all of our performance, and to we're taught to feel with the front of our bodies and project that towards an audience. But when we have the quartet sitting in the middle of the stage, we actually get a resonance from all angles and from all parts of our bodies. And I think that's a something that I know personally that I'm really pushing to develop more as a dancer, is to feel movement from not just one plane of my body, but from all angles of my body. And so working with the quartet has helped in that sense, because you're always moving around the space, and at times so are they, but especially when they're centered, we get the possibility of really actually feeling those sound waves coming at our bodies from different angles. So it creates new sensations and new, just a creates a new dynamic of moving. Yeah.
Nice. Did you have a thought on that?
Oh, it's fascinating. Because that is a way that, as a composer, I hadn't thought about. But we certainly do think in terms of 3D and space. I mean, where the placement of performers are is a huge important thing to us. Totally the opposite of using speakers. Because if you, even with an orchestra, if you put the violin one over here and the violin two over there, you get a very different sort of an antiphonal sound than if you put everybody sort of like this from high to low. And of course, having players moving around is kind of crazy. I mean, you don't get that with an orchestra ever.
When they're chasing us.
Yes, they look a little scary there, Those strings could go flying. Anything could happen. Well, fortunately not. But okay, maybe not as scary. Just wait till next time. But this studio space thing, I'd never thought about it, but it was really fascinating. Thanks for the perspective.
Delphine. Why don't you tell us something a little bit about what it's been for you to work with the musicians?
Well, it's been really interesting, just because the piece of music can at times be very, very chaotic, and for untrained ears, like dancer ears, I mean, I speak for myself, I don't really have that big of a musical background, it can be a little bit challenging to isolate the sounds, and your ear just gets overwhelmed by all the musical instruments playing at the same time. So what we've done sort of with that first part of the show is we isolated certain sounds, like the droning sound where Mark runs around the stage, and the second part with that shimmery kind of sound, we've isolated them and sort of played around as to how those sounds feel in the body and how we can explore that sound, which has helped us quite a bit then after to build the full show, the full half hour piece of music. We're able to hear the instruments way better and isolates the sounds, and then pick up from that first part, pick up those movements and sort of integrate them in the second piece of music. So in that sense, the first part is a bit of practice, and it's been nice for us to understand the music a little bit better and take time to really get to know the musicians and for them to help us understand how to understand the music.
Let's go. Great, excellent. Thanks, you guys. So let's set up for part two. So yes, just a little bit about part two then. We've given you lots of hints. The quartet's going to be in the middle of the stage, and we're going to do some excerpts out of those 17 little sections. And really, this first half, it feels like it's constantly in rehearsal, because we're always striving to find that communication that they've just been discussing, and that authenticity of connection between the music, the musician, the dance, the dancer, the movement, the vibration in the room. So it's always changing. You could argue that live performance is always changing every time, but that first section, really anything could happen a lot of the time. However, they usually get through it okay. There's, touch wood, no instrument down yet. So, okay. So the second part, string quartet number one, written in the 50s, over, I think, 52, 54, was it?
I believe 53, 54. So Ligeti was about 30, but still living in Hungary at the time, communist Hungary.
And he was very influenced by another Hungarian composer, Béla Bartók, And for him, this was an expression of his sort of understanding of Bartok's music in a way. And I feel like, well, Bartok used a lot of folk music to influence his composition, and by extension, there's some of that in here. But Ligeti, the more he got evolved in his composition, the more he got interested in structuring sound. It was much less about melody and harmony and much more about restructuring space with the sound. He would look at a cloud and think, how can I compose that cloud, right? How do you make a cloud sound like something? How do you make a sound like a cloud? So that restructuring took him into this kind of electronic and mechanico phase for a while, but he really preferred to work with live musicians. So he actually was loved by musicians because he was constantly pushing them and challenging them beyond their limits. He was also kind of loathed by musicians for the same reasons. But the idea of working with live musicians, I suppose, is you would have something to say about that.
Oh, well, I mean, of course, it's wonderful. If you have the privilege to work with people and say, can you do this? And they say, no, and then they say maybe, and then you can sort of figure out, well, how can I make this easier and more idiomatic? And working with players such as Marc Destrouvet, who I've probably worked with the most extensively of this quartet, is always wonderful. But yeah, Ligeti's music really pushes the boundary. There was one other thing that fascinated me, that you mentioned the cloud, because one of the things he does, he has those really high shimmery sounds we were talking about, harmonics and the extremes of register, and he has the notes that are really close together, like clusters. And something he started to do later, it was called micropolyphony, where there's just millions of notes all really close together at the same time, and it's this sort of frenetic, wild feeling, and yet it's a little bit static too. It's so much motion and so much stillness at the same time, and I think that's something he was reaching towards in this piece as well. And when you were talking about the cloud and structure, it was just something that crossed my mind, that sense of how to get movement and stillness just seems possibly the most important thing to this music, I find.
Oh, I like that image. Movement and stillness, a challenge for dancers. I was going to say something about... Oh, right. So sometimes I think of this piece as part high art, part entertainment, part music lesson, which you've heard quite a bit about today, and part roller coaster ride. So hang on to your straps, because we're moving into the roller coaster part right now. Enjoy.
Thank you.
Nice, guys. Awesome. That wasn't too bad for a rehearsal. We're remounting, as I mentioned, because we're taking this to Halifax in a month, and this is the best week for everyone to get together again. So we're just putting it back together, and that was pretty good for rehearsal, guys. Thank you. And there we go. So that would be a little bit of part two. And now we'll just take a few minutes to talk a little bit more with some of the artists. And actually, the dancers are going to prepare for the Jocelyn piece. And so we'll just maybe just talk a little bit to some of the other musicians. How's it going, Tanya?
Oh, awesome. It's such an exhilarating piece to play.
And how does it feel to have the dancers flying around you?
I think it reminded me, I hadn't heard the perspective Nick said before of having the music come at them from every angle. And I think for us, being in the center, if we are fortunate to perform live with dance, often we're off in a corner or behind or kind of not seen or really, hopefully heard, but not really seen. And to be in the middle and have them swirling around us is quite, it's energizing. To bring kind of both art forms together is twice the energy of each separately. The sum is greater. It's amazing. Mm-hmm.
Nice, nice, awesome. And Jocelyn, what about you? You hadn't seen it quite like.
No, I hadn't seen the sort of full 3D experience, and I'm feeling that too. And I just love the sharp contrast between something that reminds me so much of Bartok, and then this really humorous stuff that's happening, and it's kind of folksy, and then we get these more dissonant passages happening, and then there's so many changes, and I love the way the music and the movement embodies that change together. Yeah, it's pretty thrilling.
And Andrew, what about you? We get you dancing and kicking.
Oh, yeah, the kick was fun. Yeah, I didn't tear my pants. So. Yeah. No, it's been really fun, especially this. I when I feel the dancers moving around us, and we're so focused on what we're doing, it's pretty exhilarating. The whole process has been really fun. I like how you've brought this incredible idea, and you're free enough to let us do a little bit of what we want with it, and you kind of let it go.
Do I have a choice? That's the question.
Yeah, no, that's a nice thing that you've done. I think it's why this project is so successful.
Well, I definitely, when you get such a diverse group of people together, it's much more interesting to let it breathe and let each person, such mature artists, to come together and then find new things together. So fantastic having you guys with us. And thank you. So I guess we're going to clear the stage now, as much as we're sad to see you go. And I forgot about that. Oh, yeah, go and grab that. So, now thank you so much for being here to help them rehearse. And also, what's really fun is that we just heard from online that we have people watching from, I forgot to bring the paper with me.
From Boston, Montreal, Toronto, Lisbon, Portugal, Vancouver, San Miguel de Allende, Mexico. I believe I saw one from Seattle as well. We've got a lot of people in a lot of countries here.
I'm thinking I should say hi to Wanda in San Miguel. She's the only person I know there. Oh, hi, okay. Wanda. and possibly Kathy in Boston. And there's Momoko in New Denver, British Columbia. Thank you for broadcasting live. It's so great to have an opportunity to watch Speaking in Ligeti, finally, because she worked on it in the early days as an administrator for Marta Marta. And we have Cheryl in Toronto. Wow, would love to hear the 100 metronome piece sometime. Mm-hmm. Isabel in Portugal. A challenging piece of work, successful. The blend between music, movement, musicians, and dancers is very good. And Susan Weiss, who also works with live streaming technology, she says it's just brilliant. Thanks, Susan. And Kathy in Boston, really love the musicians center stage with the dancers moving around. So
yeah,
that's
too.
So fun that that people are watching this. So now, why don't you tell us a little bit about Disquiet?
Okay, so Disquiet is a piece, that I wrote a number of years ago for the CBC Radio Orchestra when it still existed, and it was based on the four-note Shostakovich theme, which if you're a musician, it's D, E flat, C, B, and they're gone, and I cannot sing, but I will tell you that it is a relatively chromatic dissonant sort of a thing. It's Shostakovich's name, D-S-C-H, the four letters that he used as his musical signature, and it's actually relatively similar to that four-note set of motive that Mark was playing for you, because that one's completely chromatic, and this one, there's two chromatic notes and one off, and you will hear it. It's the first four notes of the piece. But the best way I can describe it is that both of these things have this sort of somewhat ominous dissonant quality to them. When I was writing Disquiet, it was based on a little bit of my feeling about Shostakovich's life, somewhat like Ligeti. He was always sort of living in terror that somebody might show up at 4 a.m. and take him and his family away. He was also forced to have constrictions in what he could write and would often have almost secret codes, such as having his name in the music and other things to try to communicate to people. But he lived in these appalling conditions and wrote the most incredible music, and that was a real inspiration for me.
And that's a relation to Ligeti, too. I mean, he spent winters writing in his room in Budapest, and there was no glass in the windows and no heat in the building. And, I mean, he just wore gloves and wrote. So there is that kind of Eastern Bloc repression that they both were kind of finding music to come out of somehow. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, just to continue on that. Yeah, there's this repression and desperation and also this absolute fierce ardor to write, so that even if you don't know if you will ever hear the piece live, they did it anyways, which is quite incredible.
That is incredible. Yeah, it would be hard for me to do choreography that I could never, ever see done. But I suppose I've done a lot of choreography in my head, so maybe I do. Maybe I have done that. So yeah, it's such a privilege to actually have been introduced to Jocelyn and her music. She recently recorded or put together, compiled, I suppose, several recordings of her music from across Canada, mostly, I think. Mm-hmm. And the album's called Cobalt, and it's with the CMC label.
It is. It's on the Centre Discs label, so that's part of CMC's. Yeah, they were extremely helpful in getting that together. I mean, actually, I couldn't have possibly done it without them. So thanks, CMC.
Canadian Music Centre. And so the album's called Cobalt, but this piece is called Disquiet, which speaks to some of the same tensions and lifestyle and struggles that we've spoken about already, but it, of course, in a whole different way from Jocelyn's perspective, a little influence of Shostakovich. And because the album is called Cobalt, we thought we would just put a little cobalt on stage to change it up a bit. So, dancers, are we ready for some cobalt, some disquiet cobalt? Okay, I guess we can just leave the chairs there for now. They're not going to be in your way. We can, maybe we should integrate them. Okay, so here we go. Disquiet by Jocelyn Morlock with the dancers. Enjoy. Thank you. Can you guys get, Thoen, why don't you come and talk to us a minute, and you guys can ask the musicians to come out. So that was beyond rehearsal. That was improv that we have just been playing with just for the last few days, something completely different for the dancers to play with, just to kind of shake up their Ligeti experience and also just kind of open up possibilities for future works. So how do you feel about seeing that? Because that was...
Yeah, that was the first time I've seen that. So it's sort of amazing. It actually feels like... I've had this experience a couple of times, and it's a bit overwhelming. It's almost like everything was in black and white, and now it's in color, because this extra layer of people interpreting is just, it's so thrilling as a composer. What can I tell you? Thank you.
Well, thanks for composing it. It's fun music, especially that rhythm part in the middle, huh?
We tried.
So how is it for you to just kind of be asked to do something like that spontaneously, hardly knowing the music, responding to sound, a little bit of structure?
Well, it actually came fairly naturally because we were talking about the similarities between the works. So it's easy for us to pick up on those same things that we've been working with for almost 3 years now, I guess, when the process with Ligeti started in 2012. So so a lot of those struggles, the internal motifs that Martha is working with that feeling of struggle is showing up again here. So we have been accessing those things already. So that came fairly easily. And we're also getting more used to hearing strange rhythms and picking up on those things. So we had a bit of a leg up to approach this piece. It's really fun to, I think it's been really refreshing for us these past few days to work with this new piece of music. So yeah, it's been a pleasure.
Thanks, Luann. Thanks, everybody. So everybody, come on back out. And I'm not sure if maybe there's a couple of questions from the audience today or any other comments. That we just have a few more minutes for our official online spectacular spectacle. And we also invite you all to stay for a few minutes if you'd like to speak with the artist. But are there any questions or thoughts right now from the live audience? It's hard for me to see, actually. Any? Yes?
One other element I'd say is such is painting with music and dance. So you actually have, you're making paintings as well.
Painting of the music and dance. That's a wonderful image. Thank you. And we have nice blue cobalt color of paint for this last section.
I'd say that's a technique that I think myself and a lot of other dancers try to implement frequently with our dancing, is that idea that as you move a limb through space, it's not just in that moment that it exists, it draws through until the completion of the piece. Yeah.
Do you have a question?
I like the blue lights.
You like the blue lights? Why do you like the blue lights?
It makes the
floor look blue,
yeah.
As well? And that was fun to watch?
Yeah.
Did it make you want to dance?
Yeah.
Great, thank you. Anything else? Any other comments? Yes, it looks like we have something from the Twitter. What's that? Hold on, I'll bring the mic to you.
Question from Robin Scott. I believe she's on Salt Spring Island, and she's asking, it just went away. How much does Martha access movement from the dancers?
Constantly. How much does Martha access movement from the dancers? We access movement from each other, and we access a lot from the musicians as well. I mean, you can see when the musicians are playing, they're dancing, and it's hard to pick up on it maybe when you first watch the quartet, but they have constant eye contact and eye gesture and little movements in their face to cue each other, and we tried to work on that between the dancers to kind of pick up on subtle cues between the musicians, each other always do that, but between the dancers, they tend to be kind of broader in their movement. So actually it was quite a difficult, obstacle to come, to get over, to not look at each other all the time, right? So in fact, Nick was talking about presentational. Dancers are often taught to be out presentational to the to the audience. And in fact, I asked them to be presentational to each other, conversational, around that dining room table for that Thanksgiving dinner, right, to have that interaction. So I would say that I definitely structure a lot of the movement from what the artists on stage offer, and then it becomes a dialogue of trading off. And I think a lot of choreographers work that way because you want to work with the dancer, the movement, the performer that's on stage, but you also have a vision in your mind of what you'd like to see. So it becomes a balance between those two. Anyone else want to speak to that?
One of the things with watching the musicians the first time they came into the room, like Martha said, they had these little like eye contacts and little shifts that kind of helped each other like cue how they were doing and what they were happening next and keeping on tempo with each other. And with like more traditional dance pieces, you do that, but you're trained to hide it. So you're always trained to look through your peripherals and not actually be like, what is he doing? Okay, we're on the same time. Okay, cool. You're always trained to look like peripherally and just like kind of sense it. And same, you hear a breath and a real resonance from the musicians. And again, like a lot of the times in more traditional dance, they're told to stay as quiet as possible and to, you're breathing obviously, but not to be like, and that was one of the things from seeing that Martha really wanted to put more into the dance. So she really did. She wanted to take away that hiding of it all, and from it, instead of trying to sense each other peripherally, like just look at each other and just like sense what you're doing, and then express the breath and the tiredness and stuff too. So that was one thing that we definitely got from the musicians to put into the piece.
But you guys never get tired.
Yeah. Any other questions? Yes.
It's not really a question. It's really quite challenging for the audience. You know, I'm used to listening to music, but to see the dance and the music together, it's a lot to take in. It's really quite stimulating, more stimulating than I used to music.
That's a roller coaster ride. Oh, good. No. We wouldn't want you to get bored. But for me, I love to listen to music. But I don't always want to go and watch a concert for exactly the reason that I'd like to see more going on stage. Right? Because I'm like, they're just sitting there. They're just sitting there and playing. But I mean, of course, there's all this movement. So that's where I get a lot of inspiration and kind of watch the all those interactions that are there without them moving their feet. So, any other thoughts from the artists today, Jocelyn?
Gosh, I don't know. I might have said everything I had to say.
Wow. Okay.
To speak to what you had just said, I think also it can make a huge difference when the seating is vaulted, and so then you could get a higher perspective of the musicians and how the dancing actually circulates around it.
Uh-huh, right. The perspective today is a bit flat for the audience, so. Yes. Anything else? Yeah, Mark?
I just think it's rather interesting, kind of generational thing. I was just commenting to one of the dancers yesterday that I've noticed that everybody under about the age of 35 talks about seeing a concert, and for me that still sounds strange because I go to hear a concert. And so just addressing what you said, I think there's been a huge shift that our society's become overwhelmingly visual, and we're used to there always being music with something that we're seeing, and it's become a rather unusual active to just sit in a room and listen to music. So what we notice as musicians is we're more and more being asked to do something with something that people can see, and that's I think a huge shift in the way society experiences music nowadays.
Oh, interesting.
And also I'm gonna add to that, now I listen to the radio and I hear there's always music going on behind the people talking, and that's also new, that we can't just listen to people talking, we have to have music along with it. So there's a lot of things shifting in the way that we perceive music.
So do you think that has something to do with the fact that, you know, portable music is so accessible, and now that most people are listening to music while they're on their way to do something else? Most of the time that younger people are invested in music is when they're in transition to somewhere else. That, I don't know.
That's a good theory. I like it. Yeah. I don't have one.
Okay. I think that's a really good theory to end on today. So I just want to thank all the artists so much for your beautiful work and for being here today. So give it up for the artists. Thank you. and for Jocelyn joining us for this special broadcast. So we can watch it as an archive video. So you've just seen it today, but you could also choose to watch it another time online and see how it came out online. And thank you again to the technical team, to the Scotiabank Dance Centre, and to the Canadian Music Centre, and everyone else who helped make this happen. So
thank you to Martha for bringing
us all together. Thank you. Thanks, Hayden. It's what I live for. So, yes. So, yes, if anyone's going to be in Halifax, we'll be there May 28th. 29th and 30th are performances with live art dance and the Scotia Festival of Music, collaboration between both the music and the dance production there, which is truly what we'd like to tour the world doing. So let us know if you have any contacts. So thank you, everybody. Goodbye, everybody out there. Goodbye online.